I'll call the regular meeting back in order at 7:11. Governing board meetings are held in the boardroom at the Ben Furlong Education Center, located at 8700 South Kyrene Road in Tempe. We regularly meet on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. However, there is only one board meeting in July and December. All meetings begin at 7 p.m. We welcome community involvement and encourage people to come to board meetings and be involved in our community. School board meetings are held in public to conduct the business of the district. These board meetings are broadcast on Tempe and Phoenix Cable Channel 99, Sundays between 6 a.m. and 8 a.m., and in Chandler on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at 6 p.m., Sunday at noon, and Tuesdays at 3. The Chandler broadcast will be aired the week following the board meeting. Tempe 11 and Cox Channel 11 now also air our meetings three times a week on Tuesdays, Tuesday evenings, Tuesday afternoons, and Sunday mornings. Specific times are available at their website at www.tempegov/Tempe11. Videos of board meetings are posted on the Kyrene website approximately 1 week after the meeting. And I'll just announce that if you go to the Kyrene homepage in the bottom, very bottom left-hand corner, you can click on the YouTube icon and see our Kyrene YouTube channel, which I think is fabulous. Board agendas may be obtained from the District Office Kyrene website 24 hours in advance of each board meeting. Our Superintendent, Dr. David Schauer, Board Secretary Mary Ott, Senior Leadership, Lead Principals, and directors interested and other interested citizens are here with us tonight. The first item on the agenda is a moment of silence, and this recently we had a longtime teacher and employee who was also a prevention specialist pass away unexpectedly. I would like to ask you to keep her family, friends, colleagues, and students in your thoughts during our moment of silence. Please stand. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Sorry, I forgot to say her name. That was Mary Nelson that I was speaking about. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is roll call. Will board members please state their name for the record?
Ross Romp.
Bernadette Coggins.
Ellen Shama.
Michelle Hirsch. Let the record show that four board members are present. The next item is approval of minutes. For the regular meeting of September 13th, all governing board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve the minutes of the regular meeting September 13th.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Next item is the approval of the minutes for the study session of September 27th, 2011, and all governing board members may vote to approve these minutes. May I have a motion?
Move to approve the minutes of the study session September 27th.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Motion passes 4-0. Assuming I said aye and I did. Can I just ask Anna or someone to come up here? My screen is locked. Thanks. The next order of business is to approve tonight's agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda, including the consent agenda? No. Then may I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
I move to approve tonight's agenda.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Motion passes 4-0. The next item on the agenda is 5.0, request to speak to the governing board. Thank you. The 5.0 section is for items not listed on the agenda. Because 5.0 section items are not listed on the agenda, the board is not able to respond to comments made during the section. When a request to speak is made, please note that you are addressing the governing board only. If you wish to speak to the governing board, please fill out one of our blue cards located on the table by the door and bring it up to our Secretary Mary Ott. One card per agenda item, please. I have five cards. Is that it? Thank you. Out of respect for audience members and speakers, there will be a limit of 3 minutes for up to 10 speakers before the regular business meeting with the balance after the business portion. And since we're under the 10, we should be fine. When you're called up, if you could please state your name for the record. Nicole Quillen or Quillian?
Nicole Quillen, members of the board and Dr. Schauer. My name is Nicole Quillen, and I am a proud parent of two BRISA students, with two more in preschool that I hope will become BRISA students. 5 years ago, my husband and I had to make a very important decision for our family. We had to choose an elementary school. After touring many schools, public, private, and charter, including our local Chandler Unified School, we chose BRISA's for many reasons, one of which was its all-day kindergarten program. During our tour, we saw classrooms that were full of students engaged in hands-on activities that not only allowed students to discover new concepts, but allowed students to cultivate the love of learning. Each classroom had different areas: a dramatic play area, a circle time area, tables for writing, a block and puzzle area. As a parent, this told me that this school would not only teach my child the ABCs and 1-2-3s, but would also help to develop his social and emotional skills. The skills of listening, working with others, taking turns, using words to get what you need, and sharing are skills that every successful adult learned in preschool and kindergarten. These skills take time to teach. The more activities that a child does that allow them to practice these skills in a safe and caring environment will only allow them to become more successful students in the future. I know that kindergarten teachers at BRISA's do not waste one single second of the day. Everything they do, including walking to lunch, seems to be linked to one of the objectives. They are able to introduce concepts, explore, practice, and review. Each student walks away from one of their classrooms with the love of learning and the knowledge of the state objectives. My fear is that if kindergarten day goes from 7 hours to 2.5 hours, direct instruction will be the only method of giving information to students. This will take away any practice time, which will not foster a love of learning. It would also not leave time for learning and practicing the skills of following directions and playing with others. In a time of trying to recruit new families to the district, it would be a shame to turn away all of those families that are looking for a district that not only cares about a child's academic growth, but their social and emotional growth too. In conclusion, I strongly urge the board to make all-day kindergarten a priority. I know that without all-day kindergarten at BRISA's next year, my family will be forced to look for another district for our children. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next is Christine Hightower.
Christine Hightower, members of the board and Dr. Schauer. Hello, my name is Christine Hightower, and I'm a mother of two girls at BRISA's Elementary. I am here tonight to explain why I feel it is important that kindergarten should stay full day. Let's think about the Arizona mathematics standards for a moment. The Department of Education for Arizona has a goal for eighth graders in the 2020 school year. They want to increase the percent of eighth graders to achieving at or above basic on the National Assessment of Education process from 67% to 85%. It seems a direct conflict to these goals to reduce kindergarten to half day. Keep in mind the children starting kindergarten next year are going to be those eighth graders in the year 2020. The key to developing successful skills has to be based on fundamentals which are learned early and expanded over time. Kindergarten students are the most impressionable age group of students, and limiting their time with highly trained educators seems like a step in the wrong direction. Kindergarten is fundamental in the development of educational patterns. Book learning has to be balanced with interactive learning to allow the children to understand and apply the concepts effectively. This should be taught by the same teachers who have been trained and have the experience to provide consistency and build these fundamentals for further education. Cutting all-day kindergarten would be a detrimental to our children, and I hope that you will consider making kindergarten full day a priority at Kyrene. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next, Kim Schultz.
Kim Schultz, members of the board and Dr. Schauer, I am here tonight to stress that all-day kindergarten is something that I feel is very important. I have a daughter that is in Kyrene School District right now as a second grader who started as a first grader, and my daughter, I'm kind of on the fence with my younger daughter as far as if we would go to Kyrene or a private school. And I think it was a point of one of the board members that there are many parents that would have to have that tough choice of deciding, I can't go to Kyrene even though I love their curriculum and their teachers and what they stand for if we can't have a full day kindergarten. So thank you.
Thank you. And Carrie Brown.
Carrie Brown, Dr. Schauer, Madam President, members of the board, and community. I think the previous speakers all covered concerns of my own. Before I say what I want to say, I just want to note that I sent Mrs. Hirsch an email, and if you haven't, I would request you to forward it to the other board members, because that outlines my concerns. I'm not sure I'll cover it all right now. But first, I just want to say I have two main concerns about possibly not funding all-day kindergarten. It is equity and having a kindergarten program that is developmentally appropriate for all of our children. So I chose to move into the Kyrene District largely based on the full-day kindergarten program. My son was about to start kindergarten, so that was kind of driving our decisions. And I will say that it was compelling, but there are better options out there, and just to put that out there. And I chose full-day kindergarten in Kyrene in the hope that my son would have more time for the social developmental stuff that he needs, the academic stuff. Honestly, it wasn't a concern of mine. So I like the full-day model because it gives him that opportunity. The half-day model won't. The half-day model doesn't anywhere else as far as I've seen. And then I just want to give you a quote that I love, that not everything that matters in educating children can be measured. When you look at those test scores, I don't think the AIMS test scores really reflect what children have done in kindergarten, so just consider that. And my final note is that please, please go into kindergarten classrooms, not just your home school, the school you're most familiar with. Come to Lomas if you haven't been to our school. Go to Niños, where they didn't have one full-day kindergarten class the last time we had tuition-based model. So thank you.
Thank you. And while I'm not responding to what you said, because I can't, just a point of clarification for the community, and the board knows this, that when an individual board member receives something, we can't forward it to other board members. That would be a violation of open meeting law. So I encourage you to mail all the board members. That would be okay. And next would be Jennifer Bowen.
You can forward it to Mary.
Dr. Schauer and members of the governing board, I'm sure many of you remember me from last year, and I just wanted to reiterate the same things that I brought up last year. I have a daughter who is in kindergarten this year, doing very well, a millennial, and I think even Michelle got a chance to see her in her classroom. So I appreciate very much the opportunities that Kyrene has given to my kids. I have a daughter at Akimal who's doing outstanding, all A's her first semester of middle school. But I really appreciate the education base that Kyrene gives to the students. And I'm just afraid that they can't get it in a half day program. And the economy is a lot different than it was back when I paid for my oldest. Professionals are without, you know, jobs. 60% of my industry is displaced currently. And it's challenging for families to make it. Back then I didn't mind paying childcare and all day kindergarten tuition. Nowadays, it's a different story, and that's still the case for people. So as passionate as I was last year about it when it was my own daughter, I'm just as passionate when it's my neighbor's children and the other kids within the district and people with little ones who will be coming up. So it's still an important issue. We'll still all be here regularly to follow this issue and hopefully help guide you guys to make the tough decisions you need to make for the community. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mrs. Sharma reminded me I could forward the letter to Mary, and you could forward it to all the board members as well, so I can do that. Next is item 6.0, presentations, and item 6.01 is progress of capital improvements, May July 1st, 2010 through July 30th, 2011. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. This is one of the presentations that we do on an annual basis, and this year it's being done by Jeremy Caius. So welcome, Jeremy, and thank you.
Thank you. Madam President, Dr. Schauer, members of the board, community and staff, it is my honor to present all of our capital improvements for 2011. First, this is required under Arizona Revised Statutes 15-491K. I'm not going to read it all to you, but basically it says between September 1st and October 31st, we need to come forward with a list of all of our capital improvements. What we are going to talk about is bonds and also school facilities board building renewal, capital override, unrestricted capital, and adjacent ways. For bonds, you will see that we spent just over $18 million. And an extra note I want to point out on bonds is that we did finish last year with $17 million remaining. However, at this time, without a change in statute downtown, we're not going to be able to sell any more bonds. So under the current statute limitations, we'll be going into next year with a significantly lower amount to be able to use for bonds. So that's a reason to pay a little extra attention to what's coming out of bond tonight, because next year we may not have the availability to do the same projects again. But you can see that with those $18 million in expenditures, the majority of it was through facilities, and we had some go through transportation. None of the bond was going through technology because we're blessed to have a capital override, which is also back on the ballot, and that election takes place 2 weeks from tonight. But we began the year with $12.8 million. We sold $22.2 million to increase. And then after expending the $18 million, we had $17 million left. Here's a breakdown of some of those projects. We have our security upgrades, fire alarms. We had some roofing and skylights replaced. We had to do some heating and AC. So we had to replace some cooling towers and some chillers at some of our schools. We also redid some basketball courts, some carpet replacement, some masonry work. And we replaced some stage curtains, some playground equipment as well. We had to do some lighting fixture upgrades and some transformer replacements, and we had some plumbing fixtures that we had to add in as well. One of the more visible projects that we had coming out of the bond was our corridor project, which took place at eight of our schools over the summer that helped produce more security by encapsulating those schools now. We also have put up 14 shade structures, and right across the parking lot, you can see our new warehouse. We finished the final payout on that. And we've done some exterior painting, some restroom partitions, and a 21st century classroom over at KMS. The clicker is just not working with me tonight. We had some field renovations as well, some fencing gates, some professional services, some restroom conversions, and a wheelchair lift station that was put in. So what do we have for 2012? 2012 is still somewhat of a question mark. We have some projects that we know we have to move forward with. For instance, a central plant renovation over at Altadena. We have to take care of our cooling towers or chillers. We have to make sure that we don't come in one day and not have AC in the middle of summer. So we make sure we take care of those. However, with the legislation downtown being in jeopardy of whether we can't count on whether or not that legislation is going to pass. So right now we're pushing a lot of our bond projects back until we get that legislation passed. So we had some carpet replacements that have been pushed back. We have shade structures that have been pushed back. And we have several other projects that have been pushed back. We did do some at the beginning of the year, but the majority of it's pushed back right now, pending what happens in January when everybody comes back in session. In transportation for 2011, we bought 3 special needs buses. And we will possibly get more buses for 2012. And 3 of those would be special needs and 5 would be mainstream. We are moving forward with our voice over IP. A good portion of that is being paid for out of bond. We also have a portion of it that is being paid for out of our capital override. But now we can finally stop getting the emails that some of our phone systems are down because we'll have this nice new system in place. Don't worry, Spencer, I didn't tell him it was your school. We did get some money for SFB building renewal, and that went towards some preventative maintenance. And for 2012, there are some building repairs that are planned. Now, the one thing you will notice, although we do have a little bit of SFB trickling in, when SFB was originally introduced, our limitations went down from 15% to 5%. So it was expected that SFB would cover twice as much as bond. But if you just look at these numbers, you'll see that SFB is in the small thousands and our bond's up there in the millions. So we're not getting too much from SFB. For our capital override, we spent the majority of it in technology. We did spend a small amount in transportation as well. Some of the major projects we have coming out of technology were our computer equipment, our software licensing, smart boards, audio systems, some of the school software. We have our software and licensing fees that we have to pay every year, so that comes out of capital override. Some of our network equipment and admin computer systems. And I'll go into that level of detail. We also have desktop and laptop replacements that are scheduled. I believe we take ours currently out to about 5-7 years is the lifetime we're trying to get out of our laptops and desktops. Software and licensing, again, is something we have to pay for every year, so that's included for 2012. We have staffing. We have our ed tech specialists are funded out of capital override, and I believe 1 or 2 other of our technology folks are also included out of capital override. Our telecommunications and our network hardware and software all come out of capital override. For the transportation piece of the override, we have $15,000 for district vehicles. And then we have the heavy-duty tire changer, an AC condenser unit, and some software for engine diagnostics. For 2012, looking at replacing some more maintenance and fleet vehicles, and also for the purchase of tools and equipment. In unrestricted capital, we've done some building improvements. We've purchased tools and equipment, some furniture equipment, and some miscellaneous items as well. But you will notice that the majority of our capital expenditures are coming out of the override and not out of the unrestricted capital, which was cut by almost 50% this year from the state for our allocation. In adjacent ways, which everyone, again, who had the fun of attending my training should know that that's for the safe egress or ingress into our schools. We've put in 4 fire lane gates, a pole riser, and we had some work related to the corridor project. I'll go into the maintenance and operations override, and then I'll take questions over both of the presentations, if you guys don't mind. Cut that one out. So new this year, which is different from last year or any other year, is that we have to now do the same type of presentation for our maintenance and operations override that we receive. Now, the difficulty with trying to do the same type of presentation for the maintenance and operations override is that that override has always gone into the M&O fund and is just commingled and used for our M&O expenses, whereas capital and bond are more project-based. Everything that was on that list, you see that those are projects, and it's easy to then identify a project cost and where a project's funding is coming from. It's not as easy to identify the fact that if a school has 3 first grade teachers, I can't tell you one of those teachers is an M&O override teacher and 2 of them are a regular M&O teacher. So it's a little bit different with trying to break this level of detail out for the maintenance and operations override. However, the recent change in Arizona revised statutes now requires that between September 1st and October 31st, we also give you an update on the maintenance and operations override. And at a minimum, we break it down based on the categories that we had listed on our voter information pamphlet. Those categories on that pamphlet were elementary instructional programs, including art, music, and physical education, so specials. Middle school instructional programs, including academic and exploratory opportunities, electives. Class size in all grade levels, with an emphasis given to primary grades. K-3 reading and mathematics intervention programs, school-based student support services such as library, health office, occupational and physical therapy, speech and hearing services, etc., and other district-wide support services. Now you'll see that the numbers are rounded because, again, as I said, this is not project-based, so we can't specify to the exact dollar level as we do for the capital override and the bond. But here is a breakdown of essentially if we lost our maintenance and operations override, where we would have to look to try to pull some of that money back out. And from that, I'll take questions on either the maintenance and operations override, the capital override, or bond.
I had a couple of quick clarifications. Do we not have that maintenance and override presentation attached to our board docs agenda? Is that, did anybody else have it? Okay, I just wanted to make sure it wasn't just me and something I was doing with my computer. So the abbreviations that are in parentheses regarding the projects, and I know they're like LAG for Lagos and COL probably for Colina, but in the future, if we could either have a key or
just spell it all the way out.
Pardon me. Yeah, just for the community, because we can figure out which school it is, mm-hmm. but it's important for the community to understand what we're talking about. And like you did it with the capital overrides, instead of you said CO, but people can flip back to the first page and see that that's what that means. But as much as we can to spell things out or have a key if it's easier. And then if we can get the M&O presentation attached to board docs, that would be helpful too. Do any board members have any questions or comments? Okay, thank you, Jeremy.
Thanks.
Next is item 6.02, a presentation on Title I and Title II funds. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board. This is one of those items that was an item for future consideration, and we decided to handle as a presentation tonight. So I'd like to invite Carrie Fuerty, who you've just seen a little while ago, once again to the podium. Thanks, Carrie.
The Jeremy and Carrie show today.
Yeah.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, staff, and community, it's my pleasure to come to you tonight and talk to you about Title I and Title II in the Kyrene School District. I am the person in our district that oversees our federal programs, so it's really my pleasure to come and talk to you about another aspect of my job that I haven't really had the opportunity to talk to you about before. So what I want to start with is, what is the purpose of Title I? So the Title I is an abbreviation, and it stands for Improving the Academic Achievement of the Disadvantaged. So this is really the federal government, many years ago, identified that students that came from low socioeconomic status were not achieving at the same rate as students that were coming from average or high socioeconomic status. And the federal government made a decision at that time to begin to funnel money towards those schools in order to improve the achievement of those students. So there's really a few purposes that Title I dollars can be spent on. It can be spent on meeting educational needs of low achieving children, closing the achievement gap, promoting school-wide reform, highly qualified staff, increased parental involvement, and professional development. If you look at our Title I allocation for the last couple of years, you see a significant difference and a very positive trend for the Kyrene School District. 2009-2010, we received about $700,000 in Title I dollars, and this year we received $1.5 million. And so folks often ask, why is it that we saw this big change? Title I allocation is based on the district poverty percentage. So they really look at all of the folks that live within our attendance area, whether they have children who attend Kyrene schools or not, and it doesn't take into account any of the students that come to us from open enrollment. So it really looks at what is our poverty percentage. Title I is really allocated in four pots of money. And you are able to draw from one pot of money if your percentage is less than 5%. In 2009-2010, the poverty percentage for the Kyrene School District was less than 5%. We were at about 4.97. And so you see that we were only able to receive a smaller amount of money. In 2010-2011, we exceeded that 5% threshold. Again, it was like 5.03, so we just crept over that threshold. And you can see that that then allowed us to draw from three of the four pots of money, which increased our allocation significantly. So really what we're seeing is that demographic trend that our poverty within our district is increasing, which means that the federal government in the state of Arizona is allocating more money to us in order to address those needs. Alan.
I just didn't hear out-of-boundary students are included or not included?
Are not included. They are looking only at the poverty percentage of the homes that exist within our boundaries.
Okay.
There are a lot of rules about Title I money. And in fact, that's the joke, is that once you've mastered the rules, it's time for you to go on and do something else. I have probably four really nice, 300, 400 page books in my office that list the rules that that we need to follow in terms of expenditure of Title I dollars. And I'm going to cover just a couple of them tonight. The first one is that Title I schools, you can have Title I schools that are either targeted assistance or school-wide. In a targeted assistance Title I school, we rank order the students. So we take all of the students in the school, we give them an assessment, and we rank them in terms of the child with the most academic need to the child with the least academic need. And we are required to service students in order by their rank. So we're required to service the most academically needy and to move up that until we have expended all of our dollars. We have four targeted assistance schools in the Kyrene School District. So we, at this moment in time, run only targeted assistance programs. However, one of our schools, Niños, is in the process, which it is a year-long process, to becoming a school-wide school. The difference between targeted assistance and school-wide is that in a school-wide school, you are able to take your money and just apply it across your entire school. So you're no longer required to rank order your students. You're basically just trying to improve the academic experience of all of your students. So the rules around the expenditure of the money changes a little bit. The purpose is still the same, which is to improve the academic achievement and to close the achievement gap. Ninos, as I said, is in the process of doing that. I'm working with a team at their school. They are hoping to have that process completed, and they'll submit their application to the State Department this spring, and we're hoping that they'll be approved to become school-wide. Typically, schools with lower poverty percentages are targeted assistance, and as schools exceed 40% poverty, you start to look at more of a school-wide model, because they have so many students that need support, it makes more sense to apply the dollars system-wide. Michelle?
I just wanted to clarify for our community that even when it's targeted assistance school, it doesn't mean that the student has to be identified as low socioeconomic. And once again, back to my example of my son, thankfully we weren't low socioeconomic, but he benefited because we went to a Title I school and he received all the interventions. So I think that it was an important point that they're ranked based on the assessments.
Correct. So the biggest misunderstanding maybe that happens around Title I is that it's for low socioeconomic students. Really, the socioeconomic status is just the way that we determine how much money is allocated to that school. Once the money is allocated to the school, the money then goes to the students with the most academic need. So it's really just the only time that we look at poverty data or we think about poverty is in the allocation and identifying which of our schools need the dollars the most. Once the dollars go to the school, it really is following the students with the most academic need. The next Title I rule is that, and this is the one that we get asked about all of the time when we submit our application, is to ensure that we are supplementing, not supplanting. What happened when Title I was first rolled out was districts said, that's great, the federal government's gonna give this school and this school more money, then we don't have to give them as much money as we have before. And that really flew in the face of what the purpose of the dollars were. So the federal government requires that we prove that our district has given the same items to a Title I school that we have given to any other school, that they're staffed similarly, that they have the similar class size ranges, that we have really allocated to them the same things that we would allocate to any other school. And then the idea is that what we provide through Title I is a supplement, that it sits on top of what the district has allocated across the board. And we do a number of reports throughout the year that show and verify that we are providing our Title I schools with the same things that we provide to our other Title I schools. We are required to set aside dollars out of our Title I allocation as soon as it comes to us. So before we can allocate any money to schools, we have to do some set-asides. And the set-asides are for a variety of things. It's about district-wide parental involvement. We have to set aside dollars to ensure that we are involving parents in our decision-making processes. And as a school district that's an LEA improvement, we are required to set aside 10% of our Title I budget for professional development before we allocate to schools. And so there's this variety of set-asides that we are required to honor. And finally, I know I talked about the rules. Well, there are the official federal government rules, and I have all of those. But in addition, there's what's called non-regulatory guidance. So every time that a Title I district has asked for an opinion from the federal government about whether or not expense is allowable, they issue what's called non-regulatory guidance. So in addition to the books, I also have notebook after notebook that's filled with different kinds of guidance that they've provided to districts. The nice piece about that is that we always have a lot of reference material to go to as we're trying to make decisions about how we spend or allocate our Title I dollars to ensure that we're doing that in compliance with federal statute. So when we think about Title I and Kyrene, we really service four schools. We allocate dollars to four schools. Every February, we look at the free and reduced lunch rate of our schools, and we rank order the schools, just like our targeted assistance schools rank order their students. So we rank our schools, and we identify the schools that have the most significant need, and we look for a natural break in terms of free and reduced percentages. So we look to see, are there groupings of schools? goals. And right now, that natural break occurs after Sereno. So we service Niños, Norte, Lomas, and Sereno. And then there's a pretty significant gap. All of those schools exceed 40% free and reduced lunch, and then we go, and then the rest of the schools fall below that. Every February, we have the opportunity to re-examine that data and make a determination about where we want to draw that line and if we want to change the schools that we serve. And every February, we go through that process and we look at those percentages and we make a determination. We want to make sure that we're putting enough money in the school that they can run a complete program. When you start to really expand that out and include more and more schools, you really dilute the money and it's not as effective. Some of the services that are provided with our Title I dollars at that school is obviously additional academic staff. A number of our schools have opted to make their halftime literacy coach or their halftime math coach a full-time position at their school. In addition, a number of our Title I schools hire paraprofessionals to assist in the delivery of intervention. Our Title I schools purchase additional intervention materials. Obviously, the district, say when we purchase SIPs, we purchase one per grade level. Well, a title school may actually need two copies of that intervention kit or three in order to be able to have enough copies to meet the needs of their students, and so that's something that we purchase. In addition, our Title I schools provide a lot of professional development opportunities to their staff that's paid for through Title I. We offer summer learning opportunities. We talked about that. We run our Title I Summer Institute, which is an opportunity for those students to experience a little bit of an extended school year. And in addition, we fund district-level support to our Title I schools. That really is my position. Is funded through this grant. That takes us to Title II. Title I and Title II are a grant that are written together. It's called the Consolidated Application, but the monies are really separate and they really serve different purposes. So the purpose of Title II is preparing, training, and recruiting high-quality teachers and principals. And really the purpose of this money is to increase student achievement through improving teacher and principal quality. So when we think about Title II, I think the biggest observation about it is that these are dollars that may not directly touch children. These dollars must be spent on staff. And so that's really the difference between Title I and Title II. Title I is really about students, and we do spend some money on improving teaching and those kind of things. But Title II is really about how do we prepare and train and support the staff that we have here in the district. So our Title II allocation has experienced a very different trend than our Title I allocation. And you can see that our Title II allocation took a significant hit this year. We took about a 25% reduction. That was a nationwide reduction as the federal government made decisions about budget this year. They cut the Title II budget by 25%. And rumor in the rumor mill is that we are anticipating approximately another 25% reduction in our next fiscal year. This is tied a lot to the reform that President Obama is trying to bring about in terms of college and career ready. And his desire and the desire of the federal government is to see Title II go from being an entitlement grant, a grant that every district is allocated a certain amount of money, to becoming a competitive grant. And so we're really seeing the phase out probably in the entitlement amount, and we are expecting that there will be a competitive grant in order to receive dollars to support teacher and principal development. So how do we spend our Title II dollars in Kyrene? Well, this year we've had a lot of conversation about how we spend our Title II dollars in Kyrene because we just simply don't have as much money as we had in the past. The majority of these dollars go to professional development offerings. So when you hear about systemic math training or systemic language arts training, our grades 1 through 8 Common Core training and English Language Arts Standards that's happening right now, these dollars pay for the teachers who develop those classes, the materials that are used. So it really is going directly to the teachers in our system in order to help them become the best teachers that they can be. Our mentoring program, so our NEO, our new educator orientation, as well as KTIP, which is the mentoring program that supports teachers in their first 3 years in Kyrene, is funded from Title II. We also have mentoring for our administrators. Our regional lead principals are funded through Title II, as well as our Kyrene Administrator Leadership Academy, our Grow Your Own program to grow leaders in our district. And finally, one of the significant expenditures for Title II this year is the facilitation of the development of our new evaluation instrument for both our teachers and our principals. We are paying the facilitators who are overseeing that process out of Title II. Title II is really directly tied to teacher evaluation, and so this is an allowable expense, and this is a way that we've chosen to spend some of those dollars this year. That's really all of my presentation, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
And once again, just for clarification, in the slide it said Kala, K-A-L-A, and just for future, for the community that may not be watching, why you wouldn't want to watch, I don't know, but just in case you happen to be looking at the slide presentation. Do board members have any questions or comments? Mr. Robb?
I have a comment. You know, it's pretty popular nowadays for everybody to be critical of the state and the state legislature for their inadequate funding of education. And you know, at the federal level, you know, Carrie, you touched on the fact that these title programs are going down at the expense of these new competitive programs. And you know, it's worth pointing out that the federal government does not currently fund its promise for Title I or Title II or IDEA, and not by a long shot. So, you know, when we look at how much would be available in our district if these existing programs were adequately funded, we'd be a lot more ahead of the game. So it isn't just the state that is not funding to its promise, it is the federal government as well.
Thank you, Mrs. Sharma.
Oh, I'm just curious, now that Sereno is going to be a traditional school, how is this going to affect?
Well,
and will we know until the actual year?
Right. So decisions about funding for the following year are made in the current February. So in February of 2012, we will look at the free and reduced lunch rates and we will make a decision, you know, does Sereno still fit in that top group, which we would anticipate based off of previous year's data that it will. So we know that Title I funding will be stable for Sereno in their first year as a traditional traditional academy. Then we'll just have to watch and see what happens to that campus and how their enrollment changes, and then we'll evaluate that again in the following February.
Okay, that makes sense.
Right. Mrs. Coggins?
You know, I just would like to say, when I toured Lomas and Ninos kindergarten classes, you know, and I know people that have chose to go to those schools based on the fact that they're Title I, they do have more assistance in the class and they do have more resources. And I will say that I was very impressed, especially with the Lomas program and how those classrooms were run. And I think, Michelle, were you with me with that one when we went to, okay. But, you know, I think there's something to be said too with those, when you're looking at some of those classrooms where they do have the additional assistance and the additional help, there's a big difference than when you go into another classroom where there's 24 kids and one teacher. You know, I think, you know, and I've seen both. So I just would like to point that out, that, you know, if you're at a school that does have a lot of additional assistance, there is a difference. I say go look at these schools that maybe don't as well. But I'm very impressed with the Lomas and the Ninos programs that I've seen.
In past board presentations, we've highlighted, and I hope our community understands how important professional development is for teachers and staff. And given these are the areas, professional development, mentoring for teachers, mentoring for administrators, the Kyrene Administrative Leadership Academy, and then the new requirement to develop the evaluation instrument, clearly you have a lot of things that need to be funded out of Title II. You have funds that are going down. I understand that you look at it in February for the following year, but is it panel of you that decide where that money's going to go? Is it Dr. Shower? Is it you? Who decides?
Title II is actually decided through what's called a 2141 committee, which is actually our district leadership council with some additional representatives. We call it an expanded district leadership council, where we bring in additional teachers and support to give us guidelines about how we expend our Title II dollars. That is because we are in LEA improvement, and part of the No Child Left Behind law says that if you are in LEA improvement, you must examine a certain set of data in a representative stakeholder group and make your decisions about how you will allocate Title II. I will say that that group doesn't get to the, are we gonna fund this class or this class, but they really set the guidelines and the main ideas about how we're going to fund and the things that we're gonna fund from Title II, and then our curriculum and learning department and other departments take that and then flesh out what that will specifically look like.
So it's important for our Kyrene staff and community to understand that at one point these things may have been funded, but because funds are less, that it doesn't mean that those classes or things that used to be paid for aren't important anymore. It's just, once again, there's not the
Correct.
Same amount of money as there was in the
And
past.
We're trying to leverage our dollars in every way that we can. So you're going to see that we're not paying nearly as many teachers on performance contracts to teach classes after school. The assistant directors and the teachers on special assignment in this building are starting to pick up that responsibility. We're really trying to spread those dollars as far as we can by making really smart choices about how we're choosing to expend them.
Mrs. Sharma?
Where LEA... because of special area, special ed, or are we LEA in? It was my understanding that we were LEA because our special ed scores across the district didn't match up.
So we are in LEA improvement because we have failed to make AYP as a district in a variety of areas, and I'm not gonna say which our areas are. Originally it was in special education,
right.
But this year we have added some other subcategories, but I don't have
okay.
them written down, so I'm not
right.
gonna.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Thank you so much, Carrie, for that Absolutely. Presentation on Title I and Title II. I think that helps everyone understand those funds better. Thanks.
Thank you.
Great. Next on the agenda is item 6.03, a presentation on the Common Core Standards. This was also an item that was asked to be presented by Governing Board. I think it was Mrs. Sharma. So thank you, Laura.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Shower, the rest of the staff and community, we're glad you're here this evening to share this wonderful opportunity with us. I think it's very timely based on our earlier conversations and all the subsequent conversations. You can see the impact of this throughout the organization. This year in particular, by law, we were by state recommendation and the implementation, we were required to roll it out fully at kindergarten in both math and language arts. So those are the two areas that have been adopted, and that's what we're sharing with you this evening. So I will start by giving you some background initially to help maybe some of the questions that we had earlier address some of those. And then I've invited some of my friends from the curriculum department, Mrs. Shelley Peckins, who is our new assistant director, in the department, and Mrs. Chandra Reed, one of our TOSAs, who works with the English language arts. So they'll be able to capture some of the key points in the content areas, and I'll give you the background piece. We'll also share with you some of the assessment implications. And what you'll see a lot, and you'll hear that word a lot, it's the implications of what's happening that really are pushing a lot of our work. So it is now what we are supposed to refer to them are the 2010 Arizona standards, also known as the Common Core Standards, but they were adopted by the state of Arizona, and therefore they are the Arizona State Standards. So when we say that now, when we say 2010 standards, we are meaning the Common Core Standards. So the idea behind this, and again, this is not just Arizona there, and you'll see a slide in a little bit, there are many states across the nation that have participated in the development from the Council of Chief State Officers who started this movement to look at how do we as a nation address concerns about our competitiveness and things like that. So through that work and lots of feedback across the country, they looked at trying to create a set of clear standards that would be true across many areas.
The mobility, as you know, people moving in and out of just districts within a state and then across state to state, what can that mean for kids, and what time do you lose lag time between catching up? So I think they tried to address a number of those things. They're adding more consistency in that idea that you've heard the term college and career readiness, and what they mean by that is that you will leave high school and not be required to take any remedial courses in literacy or math. Whether you go to college, community college, or into the workforce, you would be sufficiently skilled and knowledgeable to not have to take any remedial courses. You jinxed it, Jeremy. Oh, there we go. So as I mentioned, this has been a few years in coming and adopted in 2010 here. It is a K-12 project, and the learning progressions are designed with the intent that over the course of the learning experience, you would master and be prepared at the end of 12th grade. Thank you. On the map here, that does give you the indication of the states that are currently participating. Some of the states have chosen to opt out or do their own thing. In general, the majority of states are part of the Common Core Consortium. The intent of the Common Core, when we get into the actual standards themselves, and we'll go into these in a little more detail, that it would be the same goals for our students, that there is a coherence, a connection between the work that is very focused, and that is clear and specific what is supposed to be attained and by when. The idea of the progressions, in other words, what happens in what sequence in learning bands for students, and how is that developmentally appropriate across the levels. Now, as we argued earlier, some of us may question that, but this is the reality of this is the group nationally that has determined what is developmentally appropriate. In the area of math, and Mrs. Peckins will get into this a little bit more, but the idea that it is not only what we're used to procedural and computation, but there is the conceptual understanding, mathematical practices, a whole new arena for us to attend to in terms of work and implications for instruction and what that means and looks like for students. At the end of the presentation, we'll share a little bit about assessment, but I'll give you a little preview. Some of the things that we're hearing out of the assessment consortium is that after fourth grade, you will not see straight computation on any of the assessments, which again, if you know, in your own schooling experience, I'm sure you saw lots of computation through all of your years. They essentially are saying you need to master that and be able to use it. And this is the same theme you heard with kindergarten. Not only do you need to know it, you need to be able to use it and know how to use it. And they'll also tell you in non-routine problem solving. Focus, again, that clarity, that shared understanding. When we aren't all trying to figure it out on our own, we're much better prepared to do the work. We're very excited to be part of a multi-district consortium collaborative working on just this work. We have joined with Higley and Mesa and Chandler and J.O. Combs, Scottsdale. We have folks coming from really literally all over the valley to say, you know what, this is hitting all of us, the professional development requirements, what's happening instructionally, how do we support each other to do good things for kids? It is too much for any one district to absorb all that work, and so we are trying to share that workload and in the process learning a lot and all being better for it. Everybody does better on a rising tide, and that is definitely the goal in terms of the work that we have doing. There's another slide that's going to come up in a minute, so I think I will go past that one. This is actually a little bit better. Picture's worth a thousand words. And in this case, the idea that, and you've heard this, an inch deep and a mile wide, the idea is to start to bring that in with Common Core and start to try to cover less in more depth in the time that we work with students. Again, very, very clear and specific throughout the conceptual learning as well as the skills and content knowledge, and that is a theme, and you'll see it again more specifically when Mrs. Reed and Mrs. Peckins come up, and I will have Mrs. Reed come up now, actually, so it's good timing.
Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, and Dr. Schauer. I'm excited to be here with you this evening. There are some major areas of focus in English language arts. The first is a focus on text complexity. And this is a new, this idea of text complexity has been redefined. It's not what we normally think about as how hard the book is. They're also considering the complexity of the structure of the text. And a teacher will also be able to manipulate text complexity by altering the task that the student is asked to do and considering what the reader is bringing. So the Appendix A of the English Language Arts Standard spends 16 pages defining text complexity. So it's a big idea, but we really enjoyed training teachers on it and getting to know it together. The next big point they have is that Laura talked about coherence. And this just means that there's a logical interconnection with these standards across all of the content areas. So we're addressing reading and writing standards in all content areas. The middle school teachers have a separate set of language arts standards that they will address specific to their content area, and it will complement what the language arts teachers are doing. Obviously, the elementary teachers will just be integrating across their whole classroom. There's a big focus on just connecting things and making them more cohesive. There's also a new emphasis on informational text. In the real world, we read informational text, and we need to be expecting our students to do the same thing. And it's not just read it, but analyze it, use it, and create something based on it. So they need to be able to create and defend arguments based on what they learned. And I'll show you an example of that in a moment. Moving down with focus on writing arguments and drawing evidence from sources based off their reading of informational text. They also need to have emphasis on participating in collaborative conversation. We currently have listening and speaking standards, and there are speaking and listening standards in these new standards, but there's a new emphasis on kids being able to not just in writing defend an idea, but also to orally be able to defend something and participate in a conversation with their peers, with their teachers. So our classrooms should have lots of talking going on in them. Last of all, there's an integration of media sources across all the standards. Our kids need to have access to lots of media. They actually use the word consume media in their description of this. So the use of technology in our classrooms is key in our success with these standards. As Laura mentioned, and we've heard other times tonight, there's a focus on being college and career ready. In language arts, the standards are set up in a progression. And in each area, in reading, writing, listening and speaking, and language, there is a set of anchor standards. And what the writers did is they said, all right, our college students are coming and they are failing. They are not able to take credit-bearing college courses and pass them. So we need to change this. And they said, a freshman coming to us needs to have this. So this means a 12th grader must have this, and an 11th grader must have this. And they built backwards. They didn't build from the ground up. So what that has left us with is a clear connection between our kindergarten standards and our college standards. We can see it happen over the course of their schooling. So I have an example here of a writing standard. There's a big emphasis on arguments and being able to defend your point. In 12th through 8th grade, we call it arguments. And these are just summarized standards with lots of points underneath it. But when we get down into the elementary grades, it's called opinion. And we expect kindergartners to be able to state an opinion. Of course, they have lots of opinions. But being able to write about it and by first grade, say why. And it's exciting to watch. Like, I've been working with first graders this week on getting in, and I need to experience this. Can we really do this? And it's very exciting. They're very excited, and it's possible. So we continue to work with staff and make the rollover a success. And I'll turn it over to
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, thanks for having me tonight. So, did I hit the wrong button? Oh. Thank you. Sorry. Oh.
challenged ourselves. Yes.
Our kids are better at this than we are.
Yeah.
Okay, so with the Arizona 2010 math standards, these are listed by domain. And as you can see, there is actually one domain that is spread throughout the entire K-8 grade level, and that is geometry. You can also see up here that there is one domain in kindergarten, which is counting and cardinality. And then you can see very clearly at grade 5, there are several of the domains that cut off, and new domains appear at the middle school level. So this is a picture of our transition plan here in the Kyrene School District. So basically, with Common Core, we have 3 years to go to full implementation. In the first year, we chose to implement fully K-2 with the mathematics standards. And with the other grade levels, we are implementing a few of the domains at a time. And the teachers were part of putting this together and figuring out what domains can we implement now, and then feeding off of the other grade levels so that as we get to year 3, now we're at full implementation. So I put a red box around the mathematical practices because the mathematical practices are what really tie all of these standards, these domains together. And basically what the mathematical practices do is it gives us the level of expertise that the students should have at each grade level. And so the mathematical practices is what we've already started implementing at all of the grade levels, and they are consistent throughout all K-8. So we have the same 8 mathematical practices throughout all grade levels, K-8. So some key points that we have for math. First and foremost, in kindergarten focuses on learning how numbers and what quantities are. They learn how to put numbers together, how to take numbers apart, and it's really the beginning of addition and subtraction. The K-5 standards provide a solid foundation of whole numbers, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, fractions, and decimals. And the K-8 standards stress not only procedural skills, but also conceptual understanding, so that we can make sure that all students are learning and absorbing critical information they need to succeed at higher levels. So once the students have built a strong foundation in K-5, students then can go into middle school and do some hands-on activities, learning more about geometry, algebra, probability, and statistics. By the end of the 7th grade, students should be well prepared to take algebra in the 8th grade. And then the middle school standards really have that rigor in them so that they're prepared for high school.
When you say the high school, the algebra for high school or for 8th grade, is that the one that my kids took that they got high school credit for? Is that the level of algebra, or are you talking just algebraic equations and algebra 1, I guess, is what I'm asking, because okay. A lot of 8th graders take algebra 1.
Right. So the 8th grade new standards include most of what the algebra students take currently, the high school, the one that they get the credit for, with the exception of quadratics. So it really focuses more on linearity, but they don't go into quadratics.
Okay, so how would that, as far as we're concerned, the kids that are still going to go into algebra, they'll just be that much more, I'm hoping that they'll just be that much more familiar with some of those different equations and things.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
This is really for both the ladies, or we can all speak to it, but again, the implications are pretty big around the idea of Common Core. So standards come and go and continue to change over time and always will, but what's different here is the level that teachers need to be prepared to teach students at in terms of the complexity of what they're asked to do, what kids need to be able to demonstrate. And I think it was very well talked about in the, probably the kindergarten, we all learned what we needed to know in kindergarten, that idea from rote memorization and recall to really high level applications understanding. And what does that mean across the board that we are now expecting at every grade level, that kind of, the majority of instruction to fall into that area instead of sort of the nice to have if you get there approach. It is now an expectation. And so there is a lot of professional development around that. We currently use a number of our coaches to help. That's really a majority of their work, is to help teachers look at their instruction to see if there is a match or a mismatch between what they're doing and what's the expectation for kids. What do kids need to be doing? What does that look like? What do teachers need to be doing? What does that look like different than what we've done in the past? And there are differences. And so really we're excited about the opportunity to do that. The systematic training, as Carrie talked to you about it, that's a big work of my group. Once we know what the allocation is, we take a look at our AIM scores and other data, CAS, MSS, and we say, where is the need? Where are the weaknesses, perhaps? What are the patterns that we see? And then we develop either in-house or bring folks in to help teachers with the needed training to do that. We continue to offer a number of trainings around a variety of areas, as we've shared with you in the past. Another point I'd like to highlight is steering committees in the math, language arts, science, and social studies. We have invited at least one teacher from every school to be part of these curriculum committees because of this work. We need to have a voice in every building. We have to build that communication as we look at how are we going to roll this out, how are we going to support teachers and students and do this work together. Again, it can't be the six folks in my department. There's too much work to do. And what we know is when you're engaged in this work, you understand it better. And so we see this as a professional opportunity, a professional development opportunity. And we've participated in a number of webinars and off-site training as well. So where does the rubber meet the road? And it is around the idea of assessment. And we've alluded to some of this previously, but this gives you the current incarnation of what is frequently referred to as the PARC Consortium, which I'd have to look up what PARC stands for again, but it is a consortium, a group of, it's the College and Career Readiness Group that is working on, that Arizona is actually one of the leaders in, creating the model of what this new shared assessment will look like. So the current version looks like what you see in front of you, and that is, not only is there the end of year assessment, which we are used to, the AIMS, but there is a performance component as well prior to that. And we're gonna share a couple of those examples with you this evening. In addition, Mrs. Reed talked to you about the speaking and listening component. They're looking at how you will gather that data, and you can see that that happens even prior to the end of the year. We're excited about the first two components, the early and mid-year, which they are saying will probably be optional, but would be, of course, greatly to our benefit to participate in what would be formative or otherwise early information to know where kids are at and are they going to be on track. So we're excited that, again, that's not work that we have to do, that there are groups of folks participating. So we hope that this all comes to pass. So that's the overall view, and then just for fun, we included two items for you this evening. The first is an English language arts item at the seventh grade. And again, this, we don't know this for sure, but these are the examples and samples that are being shared. So a student would, at a computer, participate in the assessment at this grade level, be given the prompt that you see there, be expected to do research at those websites, and complete the following tasks: to read that information, and create a letter justifying the views, all the things that Mrs. Reed shared with you. In the letter, what do they need to include? All those things of good writing, the six traits, so those things don't go away. And it's not, they have to do it concisely in 700 words or less. So. Now here's the interesting thing. Now I'm gonna show you a math item. it doesn't look a whole lot different from the English language arts item. So what we know about that, what we were talking about, it's not just about the computation. Kids need to be able to acquire information, use that information, come to conclusions, and share that. So this is an example that they, at eighth grade, where they get this, essentially a heating bill. Of course, I think it's barrels of oil, so our kids wouldn't necessarily be familiar with that, but the idea is there. And then their tasks. So they are supposed to assess the cost effectiveness of the idea that this person put in new insulation and window ceiling. They give them additional information about that. Here are their tasks: compare, explain, identify circumstances under which the gas bill would have been. So some other conclusions that they need to draw. Decide if it is cost effective and what is the evidence. That's part A. And part B, create a short pamphlet for gas company. Customer, and again, you can see list the quantities, generalize the method. These are fairly complex tasks, very different from the types of experiences kids typically had. We saw this in our very best situations. They take a lot of time, and of course, we would hope that we reach this, but again, it wasn't the expectation, and that's the difference around Common Core. It is now the expectation that all of our children will be able to do this, that they will have the content, the skills, the media, technology savvy to do all these things. We didn't talk too much about this tonight, but technology is embedded across both of these sets of standards, so there are expectations around students' ability to use technology to communicate, to produce, and share knowledge. So, in a nutshell, those are the Common Core standards. Thank you so much, Laura, and Shelley and Chandra as well. We do have a blue card on this item, so I'd like to ask the parent to come up first, and then board members can ask questions or comments as well. Carrie Brown.
Carrie Brown again. Good evening, Dr. Schauer, Madam President, members of the board. So there's a lot I really like about the Common Core, and I'm excited about it, especially the rigor, in spite of all the worries that that also brings. But there's one thing I want to point out, and then I have a question for you, is that I don't see social studies and I don't see science. There's a lot I don't see. I know it's the Common Core, but I think those two subjects in particular are part of the core, and I know they're coming. But I spoke to you briefly earlier when there was a presentation on student achievement, and what I've noticed over the past decade or so in Arizona, social studies and science have never yet been used to hold schools accountable. And what I've seen is that schools tend not to focus so much on those subjects all the time. So, again, I have a kindergartner and a preschooler, so I'm still in the, or a first grader. So I'm in the early grades. I haven't seen what's down the line, but I did notice, I was a little surprised, there wasn't a lot of science or social studies that I saw in kindergarten, and I think there could be more. So I guess my question is, does the district really use these standards to drive the curriculum, or do we also do our own thing? I'm hoping that that's your response, because you guys are the experts, and I hope we rely on our experts and not just what I think is being handed down from people that don't always give us what is appropriate.
And that's actually a very good question. And we shortened a lot. A lot of these things have very long titles. And the part of the title that I didn't read to you, and I apologize, at the 6th through 12th grade, there's actually a different title for the standards, and it is English and Language Arts for use in the study of social studies, science, and technical studies. So the full title includes very specific standards addressing how you use this, how you use your English language arts skills in the area of history, social studies, science, and the technical studies. And what that would look like, for instance, is here is Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. So you need to know the background to answer a question similar to what you saw there. So you need the content knowledge and the writing knowledge to be able to respond appropriately. It could be, here are the findings of a science experiment. So you would need the appropriate content knowledge to address that and develop that. Those are specifically articulated 6 through 12, but we extrapolate from that in the appendices, very specific reading, writing, and what am I forgetting, in language arts. For content area teachers. So obviously at the elementary, teachers are responsible for all of the content areas. At the middle school, it is separate, but they have very specific standards that have been identified for them to incorporate in the in those areas of instruction. We're rolling out a three-hour class to help them now manage that in their work. There are state standards in science, and so you should be seeing science, so we probably need to chat if you're not seeing science, because there is an expectation around science and social studies still being a part for all students. So thank you, and I'm sorry that, you saw that, because that's something we need to address.
Thank you. Mr. Robb?
Thank you, Laura. That was really very informative. You know, it all sounds great, I guess. But I guess the devil is, as always, in the details. You know, how does this kind of then manifest itself in new state-mandated curriculum, new resource adoption, professional development, new assessments, some idea of maybe getting away from teaching to the test? You know, how does all of this kind of manifest itself in the real world and making the transition in all of those areas?
There are a variety of impacts. Certainly resources that were adopted several years ago do not specifically align to the Common Core. So work from our steering committees and other folks, and over the last year, Mrs. Southern and Mrs. Reed and other folks have been going through what do we already have access to without expending additional dollars to say, students and teachers have the materials in their hands to be able to teach at the level that we're expecting them to do. So there was a lot of work already put into that, and we have, yes, there are gaps, but they identified a number of resources. And of course, because of the internet, it is very easy to tap into a number of very strong resources. And with the switch of emphasis from fiction to nonfiction, it makes it even easier for us to acquire and look at, and in fact, really drives needing to do more social studies and science, because that's a natural area of nonfiction for students to engage their learning in. So that's one part of it. The second part of it, the collaboratives that I was mentioning to you, that's exactly the work of those groups. Nobody has adoption money right now to go out and buy new materials. So we have to say, how can we share what's happening? We've talked about and looking at, a number of us use similar tools, technology tools. So if we create maps and lesson plans and content, we are working to share that work across the district. So nobody is left without what they need to do their work. And we currently feel like we've made some fantastic inroads in that, and that is continuing to be part of the conversation to make sure students and teachers have the right the right materials and the right professional development. As I said, that's part of our goal. Kyrene has a wonderful, strong history of professional development. You were actually ahead of the curve before even the standards were adopted. You were doing a number of really forward-thinking professional development, cognitively guided instruction, and best practices. You, again, at the forefront of the work, which has put us in a good place to actually not be taken quite by surprise by a number of the things that are in here, because we already have folks who are along that road in terms of being able to match that skill instructionally.
Right. Well, that answer would seem to indicate that the implementation is going to be done at the district level.
Yes.
And a lot of it's going to be done at the district level. But what about the situation that we're more used to, which is what goes on at the state level, the mandating of curriculum, standardized testing? How's the state going to be? You know, if you're talking about not being an inch deep and a mile wide anymore, then that must mean that the tests are going to take on a new form, that we're going to focus tests on being not so wide and a little deeper.
Exactly.
So somewhere along the way, for example, the Ames test would have to be redesigned, theoretically, to test deeper and narrower than wider and shallower. So how does the state get involved in this process?
Sure, and that's a really good question. The examples that I shared with you at the end of test items would be the new state test items. As part of the work, because it is now a collaborative, it is multiple states, we are working with a number of other states to develop the new assessment tool. So there would no longer just be an Arizona tool, it would be a tool that would be used across multiple states. And we are, as I said, a front runner and a leader in that work. So in terms of, yes, there is a change to assessment. What we're hearing again is that at the from about the fourth grade on, they're anticipating that it would be on taken online, much like what you saw there. And again, along those lines, Chandler or Kyrene was ahead. And with the purchase of SchoolNet and other products, we've developed online tools. We rolled them out. We've been doing them in somewhat low-stakes fashion so that both teachers and students get familiar with an online testing environment so that doesn't interfere with getting an accurate measure of a student's ability. So there are a number of pieces coming together. Now, as always, as in the past, the state adopts the standards. The rest is up to us in terms of the materials and how you go about it. So there's good and there's bad to that. There's a lot of flexibility, and we have the choice to determine what materials we want to use. But then the challenge is everybody's out there trying to figure out that.
So just one more real quick question, which is maybe more of an opinion question. And since you're the one with the microphone, I guess it's your opinion that we'd like to hear. You know, it would seem to me that if you take this for kind of the best of intentions, that everybody's trying to do the right thing here, it would seem to me that there's a real opportunity to start moving away from the concept of teaching to the test, that we're really trying to give a deeper amount of skill and knowledge to kids. And I mean, do you think that there is some potential here to kind of, to whatever extent teaching to the test means to any of us, that there is a certain ability to actually give kids a deeper and more kind of content knowledge and not move around as quickly and get away from the teaching to the test concept?
Yeah, I believe that there is. And again, teaching to the test sort of has a bad connotation. There's actually some really good curriculum development that talks about understanding first what it is you need kids to understand, be able to do, know and be able to do, and then figure out what does that look like? How will I assess students to determine that they can actually do it? And then designing my instruction so that they will, in fact, have the learning experiences that they need to be successful on that assessment. So a little bit of a misnomer on teaching to the test, but I think your intention is, here's what it looks like. I find out this is the way it gets assessed, and therefore I change my instruction to match those specific items. Mm-hmm. We won't be able to do that, not with those types of items, because the demand and the fact that you could come to different conclusions that can be, in fact, correct if you use the right kind of thinking and justify it. So it's a very different place than where we've been typically in large-scale assessments. And so I'm excited about the potential for that and the idea that, again, all kids will have the opportunity to get to those very highest levels. I think of sort of the Socratic dialogue and those other types of really engaging learning experiences, because that is now the expectation for all kids to be able to engage in that and then be able to generate information and knowledge and share that and communicate a valid opinion with evidence for what they're doing.
Thank you. It was a nice job. Appreciate it.
Just one second. I'm going to be short. I'm wondering about developmental readiness for things like geometry. It used to be said that children who took geometry before the age when they're sophomores, many of the children had trouble visualizing. They just weren't ready to. And I'm wondering if that's still valid or things like that. I here again, I have a hard time pushing kids ahead. Right. Or algebra, you know, and or calculus as a senior, which when my kids went to Corona, they didn't even offer it, or physics or advanced physics. So I'm worried about that. I'm also concerned about our math curriculum and the materials to back it up. I've heard it over and over again that we don't have a coherent math program that we can give our teachers to follow, that it's like one from column A, two from column B. And I wonder if the consortium is working on something or that's coherent for the teachers to follow.
I think there's a couple of challenges there. In particular, I think, again, from coming from another district and coming in and seeing what you've done, Kyrene made a huge commitment to probably the very best tool that's available on the market right now in investigations. Not only that, you went to investigations too. So we have one of the best available tools to do that, and a lot of training and and Shelley can speak to that even more specifically. And I think the idea that that any one tool will ever do all of the things that we're asking kids to do, I think those days have probably gone away in some respects. So the idea that one textbook, one source is
going
to create it.
Well, I know you're going to be taking from a lot, but I also know from experience that investigations, one and the other targets or objectives, they never quite fit right.
Okay, well, and I'll let Shelley speak to that because I think we just shared this with the middle school principals to show that Investigations 2 has the best match.
I'm not familiar with that.
Has the best match, and that is what we're using. Do you want to speak a little bit to that?
Okay, so with regards to investigations, and you know, I was an eighth grade math teacher last year, and so I used all of the materials that were given to me. So as a teacher, what I had to do was I had to go through all of those materials, and I had to really know my standards and really myself match them up. And so, unfortunately, there really isn't one resource that we could purchase that would fit to, you know, really any given curriculum, you know, set of standards. So with regards to the investigations, they really are a good match for the standards and for the Common Core standards. I think the difference in the elementary school and then going to the middle school is at the elementary school level, you're really looking at the students learning and understanding the basic concepts of addition, of subtraction, of multiplication and division, and that's what the investigation materials do. It gives them that solid foundation so that they can apply that when they get to some of the higher grade levels.
But then they had the Carol Fosnett.
Right.
And they just had a really hard time, and I don't want to take up more time because it's getting late, but a hard time meshing them. And these are from teachers I've taught with and respect a lot in their teaching of math. So you might want to look into it.
Absolutely, and you make a good point. And again, the steering committees, that's one of the reasons why we're pulling those folks together, because they are the folks out there doing what we ask them to do and telling us this works, this doesn't work, and how do we become more efficient with those pieces and help map those out, the pacing guides, where does this resource fit, where does this resource fit, so that every teacher has that support to do that. So as they're working to differentiate within their class, they know where they need to go. So.
And I just want to say, Kyrene has always been ahead. We had writing across the curriculum group. I forgot, might have been Jerry that handled that. We've always had the math like what's there. I'm really proud of what our district does. And I hope with budget cuts and everything that we maintain that level.
Mrs. Coggins?
I was just going to say probably more of a comment that, you know, with us being a K-8 district, I see that it's more critical now than ever that we collaborate with the Tempe Union High School on this. And you did state that we were working and that Arizona was at the forefront and all of that. But since we're such a great district and progressive on all of these things, is Tempe Union right there with us, locked arms? Because
they are now.
Okay, good.
When I came on board, one of the first things I did was figure out what was the status of the relationship between the districts, and it is a good relationship, so we were able to build from there. Derek Hofflin, the current curriculum director, is actually a 20-year veteran math chair department, and we have a meeting with him on Thursday, Shelley and several of our folks. We've already convinced them to share with us their midterms and finals to use in our online environment so that we can, again, give kids that opportunity to learn that. They're coming to look at our curriculum map so we can share with them. So as they're doing their mapping, they're looking at doing some more consistent adoption. As you know, each school is allowed to adopt different material in Tempe Union, and that is something that's most likely going to change under this in this new model. So we're very excited, and we have the same concern because, of course, while we are K-8, these are K-12 kids, and we need to be mindful of that all through all our work. It is not terminal. We do worry what happens after eighth grade.
Well, and I think that, you know, we're so worried about kindergarten and first grade and second grade, and again, like those of us that have been through, we see where at the end, I mean, our goal is them to graduate from high school and get to college and do all those things. And this is a lot of information. And if they get to whatever high school it is that they end up in, that we are united. So that's good to hear that. And then Ross had stated, I feel like this got really loud, or is it late? You know, how much have we had to put into implementation? And you basically talked about that, but if we had to buy a lot of material, because I know we're not getting additional funding for it.
You know, essentially, in a perfect world, we would go for a new adoption, and we would look and see. But I would tell you, the publishers don't even have new materials. They're kind of repackaging and slapping on Common Core as a label. And I would be very cautious of buying anything at this time. Even if we had the money, I would be very cautious, because I'm not sure that they're not just repackaging the old stuff and saying it matches.
Because I was doing some research back when it first all started, and when I would go, and it was just, you know, Google searches, it was very basic stuff, but a lot of it was coming back to, like, Pearson were the big funders, and yes, it was a lot of textbook companies, mm-hmm. And then I thought, oh, great, you know, we're already worried about this, but now they're going to give us this Common Core, we're going to have to purchase new materials, and that was kind of a red flag for me, so I'm glad that we're...
We found a way around that. We're working together, so we don't have to.
Thank you. I think this is such an important presentation because I know board members, and I'm sure district staff, have received a lot of questions, and perhaps parents and community members have some misinformation. So this helps clarifies a lot of that, and we can always refer people to watch this part of the board meeting to get some more information.
To talk with anybody.
Thanks. And if I could just add that, as Ms. Coggins said, you know, the goal is obviously for our kids to meet the standards and then go on to high school. And I've already shared about my son Tanner, who will be just fine. But it's an important point that while he's at college, I am paying for 3 remedial classes. And it would be great if I had that money to spend on something else. So that would be a goal for all of our students, that they didn't have to take those remedial classes like as you mentioned. Thank you so much again, Laura and Shelley and Chandra. Sorry.
I wonder if we're going to be able to do this with half day eighth grade. Is that going to be possible?
I don't think the parents would be so happy with half day. Right?
Probably.
We have parents revolting that their eighth graders were home for half the day, perhaps. Okay, I think we're good. Dr. Shaw, good? Okay. The next item is, don't go anywhere, Laura.
Yep.
6.04, presentation on the A3F grading system, something we've also had a lot of questions about.
So I shared with you some of the basic background information that we had at the beginning of the year, and now that the labels and letter grades have been publicly released, we can share those specifically with you. And then I thought I would recap some of the key points, and perhaps it will sink in a little bit better. I know it's a lot of information. I actually met with the Director of Accountability from the Department of Education yesterday for about an hour to ensure that the information I have and that I'm sharing with you is accurate, and he has agreed to come out, and he's going to work with our principal team, our administrative team, to also share with them how to understand this and how to use it to help us in our work. So we're very excited that he'll be coming back out to visit with us. So the designations in this first year, as you know, is A, B, C, or D. There were no Fs, because an F meant that you have a D 3 years in a row. So all you will see is A through D on any of the schools that are listed. At middle school, Alta Dania reached the threshold for an A. All of our other schools are in the B category. The legacy label on the far right is the system. There are 2 concurrent systems. If you'll recall, this year we're still using, for accountability purposes, the legacy, what's called the legacy model, which is excelling to underperforming, and then the new letter grade system. There's no correlation between the two different formulas, so just a reminder on that. And then for our elementary schools, as you can see, we had 12 A's, 11 B's, and 2 C's. This is the piece that's a little bit of a review for you to help, again, just share with you one more time. And there are more things. This is actually from the state document, so that you could see what parents could actually go and see, and we can make available to them as well. When we talk to folks about how this is different than the past, and that is the left side of the circle is about student growth. And it is looking at student growth over time. It is looking at students compared to their academic peers. It is looking at how they do on scale scores. So there are multiple facets to how they're defining growth, and that's really what I was able to glean from my conversation yesterday, is exactly how do these different things, how are these different, and they are. And so that would take probably another several hours, mm-hmm. but the gist of it is exactly what we've shared with you in the past, is that how are all kids doing, and then how are kids whose scale score was in the bottom 25% coming from last year to this year, how did they do, and then you get double credit for those students. On the right-hand side, those are the number of students meeting exceeding aims, which is what we call the status. So it's just how did they do at that point in time. There's no growth comparison. It's just how did they do at that point in time. And then there are some extra credit points for dropout rate, graduation rate if you're a high school, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, and the ELL performance, and that is a reclassification rate. So when students are with you, for them to be reclassified as fluent English proficient students, that rate changes each year. It goes up. Last year it was 30%. However, there were some difficulties in the model, and I've shared with you the, you know, a number of recalculations before it went public. They used the 2010 data and basically said, gave you the benefit of the doubt. If you made it previously, they gave you the points this time, and they are working on that part of the formula for next year's release.
Laura, yes. The bottom 25%, is that across the state or is that in district?
It's at the school level.
It's at the school
level. And it's based on scale score.
All right.
And the score range, again, this is the same as what we've shared with you before, 140 to 200. The state does have the top districts in the state listed, and you'll notice that even though it says 200 is possible, that would mean you have 100% meets and exceed and 100% growth, which is impossible. So the highest in the state was 156. So if that gives you a relative, you know, positioning, I think it's helpful to keep that in mind. And so how do you end up at that? Of course, we're always interested in being an A or Kyrene. Mm-hmm. So how do you end up being an A? There are a number of ways that you can do that. So here's three different schools with three very different profiles, yet they were all able to accomplish the highest designation. So there on the far left is the high-performing school. 95% of the students are meeting exceeding aims. That's a very high-flying school. On the left-hand side, the growth means, and if you'll recall from before I shared with you, 50 is what they would call typical growth or an average growth. So 50 is normal, and that's what you're shooting for. You're doing as well as 50% better, as well as or better than 50% of the students in your group. So this particular school has slightly below average growth, but still, because of their high overall performance, they're able to reach the highest level. The school next to them, slightly overall lower meets and exceeds, however, they exceeded far higher than most districts would on the growth side. The range of typical growth, when they say what is strong growth, it's about 63. So between 50 and 63 is good, and that's what we would be shooting for. On the far right then, here's a school who's obviously has a lot of challenges at a 78% meets and exceeds. However, they have really strong interventions. Kids are growing and moving. And they also, you can tell, serve an ELL population. They are not penalized for that. They, in fact, because they move those students, get an additional 3 points. And so they are also an A school. So while, you know, there's a certain idea that an A is an A is an A, these are three different profiles. And if you read any of my numerous articles in the paper, that was exactly the conversations. You still, at the end of the day, need to visit that school. You need to see what's happening with the leadership, with the staff, with the climate, because it isn't all summed up in a letter. It is still about all the work that goes on in that building and what it looks like and how it feels. So we hope that people won't ever forget that in this process. We understand that this is familiar to people, and that's the intent of Superintendent Hoopenthal, is to make something that is familiar and understandable, because excelling and so on was not. But I still, again, it is only one piece. Just like when you go to the doctor, they check out a number of things to see how healthy you are. I would caution that folks remember the same thing with this new model. Questions?
My big problem with this is when I say to myself, where would I want to send my children? Even though they all rank A,
there's really big discrepancies.
It depends on the needs of your student.
Yeah.
Right? Exactly.
Yeah. But I still don't think it's representative because test scores, the higher the test score, the harder it is to raise them.
Not necessarily, because again, as long as you maintain, as long as you stay healthy, mm-hmm. so if you have that meets and exceeds in the 90 plus range, which a number of our schools do, as long as students grow at 50, in other words, they grow as the same as other students in their same academic peer group, 90 plus 50 is 140, and you will make an A.
Yeah.
It is accounted for. I know it seems like it isn't, but it is accounted for.
Mr. Robb.
A couple of things. Presumably, you have the score breakdown for each one of the schools, so we could see that if we
Absolutely.
Presumably anyone could see it who wanted to. You know, I think that, you know, along the same lines, kind of as the Common Core that we were talking about, while I'm sure we could all argue that this isn't perfect, for the as long as I can remember, everyone's talked about getting growth into the computation. So, you know, I guess no good deed goes unpunished.
Be
but this one seems
ask.
This one no. I mean, this one actually seems like a pretty good attempt at getting it right.
They are. And the other piece that I was going to come back to is the extra credit piece. When you look at the top districts in the state, all but two are high school districts, and that is because they can earn an extra 6 points for graduation and dropout rate, which we are not able to do. And so when you deduct the 6 points and you look who's left, we're ahead of some of our neighbors, just FYI. But I did bring that up with the director of accountability. I said, are they going to address that? Because, of course, the students in Tempe Union were with us for quite a long time if they went all the way through our system, and they were with Tempe Union for 2 years. So they are considering how to address that in the formulas to say, well, clearly as things play out, we're not doing significantly worse than a unified district. We just don't have the opportunity to be awarded points based on graduation rate or dropout rate.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And just a promise to board and staff that in the future, as I, as president, with our vice president and Dr. Schauer, who plan agendas, will work harder at getting the either fewer presentations or get a better understanding of how long, because I understand it's late. We do happen to have a lot of information that we need to get out to the community, but I just want you to know that I'm not unaware of the time, and so just to let you guys know that. Next item is 6.05 board briefing, and that is for me to provide information on the K-8 meeting I attended, and the explanation in the agenda also says that board member Beth Brazell will provide information on the Citizens Budget Committee. She had to leave our meeting a little bit early to attend something for her son, and so she isn't here to do that. She can do that at a later date. I will, and the purpose of this item on the agenda is as board members attend the various committees in the meeting that we can come back and to the board and share what is going on at those meetings. And that is part of that whole budget process diagram that most of us have seen that shows the connectedness of sharing information with all stakeholder groups. Just for people to know, board certainly knows this, that the K-8 Programming Study Committee meets a couple of times a month, and they are made up of parents, support staff, teachers, and administrators. So it's a group that hears information and reviews programs for effectiveness and efficiency. At the last meeting, that was on October 18th, I attended. There was a presentation and discussion on the status and the work planning of the traditional academy. Lots of questions were answered, and I don't need to tell you all the questions and answers, but I can tell you that there is a frequently asked questions page on our website, and there are other links on our website under the innovative programs. Lots of information about traditional offerings in other districts and links to curriculum and resources and that kind of thing. There was also a presentation on the innovative programs or choice programs, and lots of questions were asked and answered. And once again, there's a whole bunch of information on our innovative programs on the website. There was also a special area survey update given by Dr. Taylor, that reviewed the special area teacher survey questions, and I believe Dr. Taylor will be coming back to a K-8 meeting to share the teacher comments for that survey, and then we can all also get that information as well. And I already told you the goal of these briefings, so there we go. I think I get an award for how fast I did that. You're all going to have to. Anyway, next item is 7.01, the consent agenda. May I have a motion to approve tonight's consent agenda?
Motion to approve tonight's consent agenda, item 7.02 through 7.10.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Motion passes 4-0. There are no action items under 8.0 for tonight.
Oh.
And we can read the information items under 9.0. And then item 10.0 is the items for future consideration. Do any board members have anything they want to add to that list?
I do. Actually, kind of on the heels of tonight's very nice presentation about Title I and Title II, I think we should have a similar presentation on IDEA.
Noted. And everyone else can see that the status of the other requests and when we plan to present those. It's not on the screen, but you have it in your agenda. And the 11.0 are the meeting dates listed. Item 12.0 is Governing Board Reflections and Development. Do any board members have any reflections to share?
Too tired.
I just want to add that Jeremy mentioned a couple of times at the study session and that for those that didn't attend the Citizens Budget Council trainings, you may not know this information or that information, but I believe those trainings will be available online soon. So if you didn't get to attend, that will be available. And I know Dr. Schauer doesn't have any reflections. So the next item is...
Move to adjourn.
Thank you.
Second.
You guys are ahead of me. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Thank you, everyone. Adjourned at 9:02.